We made this.
Cerebral Jukebox is proud to be part of the We Made This podcast network. Hello there, thank you very much for downloading this episode. My name is Carl Bryan and I am the world's first brain surgeon slash therapist slash jukebox repairman. This is Cerebral Jukebox, where a guest tells me about a song they found so catchy, it's stuck in their head on repeat, we have a bit of a chat about it, then I give them the chance to remove it from their internal memory forever, or they can keep it for prosperity. Today I'm joined by a musician and podcaster who you can currently hear on the Midlife Punk podcast dissecting the classic compilation Short Music for Short People. It's Niall Maconachie. How are you doing, sir?
Thank you very much, Carl. I'm great, thank you. Thank you for having me today.
Not a problem. So let's dive into it there. What track is it that you picked for us today?
Today, Carl, I've picked the 1972 classic from the Osmonds, Crazy Horses.
Released in 1972 from the album of the same name, the band decided they wanted to release music that reflected themselves more, as opposed to their previously pop-centric releases. The track was written in an hour, and is a commentary on the pollution caused by cars. However, it has been misunderstood, as the song has been banned in France as the lyric "Smoking up the sky" was thought to be about drugs, and sales in South Africa was prohibited as censors believed horses meant heroin. It's been covered numerous times over the years by bands like Lawnmower Death, the sensational Alex Harvey Band, KMFDM, Electric Six, and Westlife, and it's credited as being the breakthrough single for the Osmonds, being number one in multiple countries. So, when was it the first time you remember hearing Crazy Horses?
Oh gosh, this would have been way, way back in the day. I remember, I think it was about sort of 86, 87. For some reason, my mum and dad managed to get hold of an 8-track machine, which was obviously cutting-edge technology in like 1986. But we had a couple of 8-tracks. We had the, you know, the Jim Reeves collection. We had all sorts of country stuff that just wasn't interesting. But I found the Osmonds Crazy Horses and the machine, and to me, as like a 6-7-year-old, that was just phenomenal. Just that it felt like such a hardcore banger at the time.
I mean, it still is, isn't it? We were sort of chatting about it beforehand. I sent you there's so many different covers of it as well. I sent you the Throat version, which has got Neil Fallon from Clutch on it, and that's my favourite version of it, because I think anybody, if they do it properly, it is a proper banger, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. You don't really have to deviate that far from the original either, in terms of, you know, the basic, it sounds really lame, but like the rocking outness of the chords and the sort of driving beat behind it as well.
Yeah, I mean, so talking about that, there's so many different parts to that song which we could class as the hook that would catch you on if you were listening to it. What part of that was it for you? Was it the keyboard, the wah, or was it the riff? Or
first ever time I heard it, it was definitely the riff. It was like, wow, this is a stomper of a riff. And then when the keyboard bit came in with the wah, that just knocked me sideways. I was like, that is amazing. More bands should use that kind of effect in their songs.
Yeah, I mean, this was something at the time that obviously beforehand they were doing more, what would be now classed as like boy band sort of style music, and then they went straight into, well, they transitioned into this kind of thing. Had you heard of the Osmonds before this? Were you a bit surprised that this was
I'd heard of them before, and like you say, I just thought there were some kind of, you know, bubblegum sort of pop bands, you know, band like family band, you know, very, I didn't know this at the time obviously, but very sort of religious and wholesome and things like that. And I suppose if you knew the whole story of the Osmonds up until that track, I guess like you'd probably be blown away the first time you heard that too.
Yeah, and I mean they switched around as well. It's not Donnie, who was basically the lead up until that point singing that, but he's the one. I didn't realize until I looked into this,
he's the one doing the wah part on the keyboard.
And, he is, yeah. There's a sort of semi-classic video that accompanies this. I believe it's on Top of the Pops from that year, where they're just like all stood there. I know they're from like, you know, Utah or whatever, but they're stood there looking like the coolest people on that stage as well. And then when you hear the rest of their catalogue, and it's like, I feel like I've been missold a little bit here.
Yeah, it's one that stuck out, but it's the one that's, I mean, it's the breakthrough one that they had, wasn't it? It was number one all across Europe. It was only top 20 in America, but obviously it's lasted a really long time in general since, I mean, it's nearly getting on for 50 years in a couple of years' time. It's nearly a 50-year-old song.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And I saw there is footage of them. The Osmonds themselves have been going for longer than 50 years because I found some footage of them on online of them performing it at their 50-year anniversary
concert. God.
And they still give it some, not as much as they used to, but they give it some. They did the thing where they have the fireworks shooting out the end of the guitar.
Brilliant.
And I was like, that's perfect. So they may not dance as well as they used to, but they've got fireworks shooting out the end of the guitar.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, Donny Osmond nowadays, he's got that sort of... I mean, I'm sure he's a nice guy and everything. He's got that sort of punchable American chat show face now, hasn't he? I can't really kind of...
Yeah.
You know,
the hair that doesn't move.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't really imagine him doing that sort of 50 years down the line, but I'm definitely going to look out for that.
Yeah. It's on there. What we'll do is we'll put it on our YouTube playlist that'll be out when this goes out of performances of all the songs we've had on the show so far. I mean, so just going back to sort of finding it, did this fit into what you were listening to at the time, or was it something that was a bit of a bolt out of the blue?
At the time, I was heavily into, I think Queen were probably my first sort of favourite band, my first real kind of obsession. And obviously they had... you know, their sort of rocky kind of style, but at that time it was sort of, you know, a kind of magic album and things like that, which meant they'd sort of toned it down a bit.
Hmm.
So just hearing like aggressive guitars, that's going to sound really weird, Osmonds, but hearing those aggressive sounding guitars on Crazy Horses kind of made me think, yeah, this is definitely sort of, you know, what I want to listen to more of kind of thing.
Yeah. I mean, With the Osmonds, you could argue that they may have gone back more into their poppier roots as time went on. But did this get you into the Osmonds? Were you sort of following the Osmonds a bit more after discovering this? Or?
No, this is like the only song that I like from the Osmonds. Because then, like, you know, as we all know, a couple of years later, little Jimmy came along and just, you know, set them back like 20 years in terms of you know, the output sort of thing.
Yeah, because we were talking about this. We've talked about the different covers there are. Now, you yourself, I thought I'd found a nice little sort of hidden gem here, because you yourself were in a band called Bleeder, or still are in a band called Bleeder.
Yeah.
And when I was looking on Spotify just for different covers of the song, I noticed there is a cover of this by a band called Bleeder. And I was like, oh, brilliant. This is what Niall's not told me, is that he's actually done a cover of it that got released. But it's not you, is it?
Sadly, no, it isn't. I mean, I discovered that myself a few months ago, and it's a fairly decent cover. It's probably the kind of style that we would take ourselves, but
yeah,
I'll get it done one day.
Yeah. Well, I mean, why do you think it is that it's so coverable? Do you think it's just because it's that riff or the...
I think there's a lot of things. It's a song that, like I said before, you don't really have to kind of deviate from. You know, you don't have to add weird floaty synths or, you know, a different beat to it kind of thing. I think it's just that catchy kind of sort of foot stomping beat that it has. And then you've got I guess it's probably a kind of a bit of a novelty with the whole wah thing. I think people who cover that tend to really kind of try and make that bit stand out, try and put their own sort of spin on it. And I think, yeah, that's probably the reason why it's one of the, you know, most popular sort of covers out there, because it's just really simple.
Yeah, I can imagine if you break it out to light. Have you ever done it yourself at a gig or?
Unfortunately not, no. It's one of those covers that I've always kind of banged on to the rest of the guys about doing, but they were just like kind of... yeah, no, it's the Osmonds. Like, I don't care if it's the Osmonds. Listen to it.
Yeah. Well, that's I can imagine if, with it being the most popular one that they've ever done and such a sort of stick-in-the-head song, I can imagine if a band did cover it, they know that even if they've not got any big sort of hits or anything to play at a gig, if they've got a cover of Crazy Horses, you're going to get the crowd into it for at least that song.
Oh, definitely. That should be in any band's sort of arsenal. That should be their little sort of hand grenade. But if the you know, if the crowd's not responding, just lob that in there. Boom, everybody's up. No question.
Yeah, I mean, I mentioned earlier I sent you the throat version of. Did you have a chance to listen to it?
Yeah.
It's weird because it's nothing like anything else that band does.
Yeah.
And they'd got Neil Fallon from Clutch on there, and it's like, this is basically what they're remembered for, but no one could even tell you what anything else they'd done or what the actual singer really sounds like, because when he appears on it, he's so filtered, and everyone remembers Neil Fallon doing the chorus. But yeah,
that's it. It could also go the other way. If you release that as a cover, that might be the song that you're known for and kind of nothing else. So that's the downside of it.
Yeah, well, as we tend to do in this show, I do give you the option to have the song removed from your Cerebral Jukebox forever, or you can choose to keep it. Now, what would you rather do?
I would like you to remove that song, please.
Really? Why would that be?
So, when I hear it again, which I inevitably will, I'll get that same rush and that same, like, feeling of whoa that I did the first time I heard it.
Right. Ah, right. We'll get that sorted for you.
Thank you.
Jax, would you mind tethering the crazy horses for me?
Tethering crazy horses? Wah. Wah.
Oh, that stings a little bit. Oh, thanks for that, Carl. Oof.
Oh, that is not a problem. Well, I hope you enjoy Crazy Horses all over again. Where is it on the internet that people can find you now?
People can find me on YouTube. Just search my full name and you'll find me on there. There's also a Bleeder page under construction there as well, which has got a couple of videos of me and Aaron messing about. And that's pretty much it. I don't do LinkedIn.
No. And also you're on the Midlife Punk podcast as well.
I am, yes. Episodes with Tom, we've got two out of a series of three so far. As you mentioned, they are dissecting the classic 1999 Fat Wreck sampler, Short Music for Short People. A lot of controversial opinions on there as well, a lot of fun. Would really appreciate it if you took, I was going to say 10 minutes to give us a listen, but they're both hour-long episodes, so yeah, give those a listen, and hope you enjoy them.
Brilliant. Well, thank you very much for coming on.
Thank you for having me, Carl. Always a pleasure.
So that was Niall Maconachie. I do want to say thank you to Niall. He is pretty much the dictionary definition of a lovely chap. If you do want to check out any of his work, be it on the Midlife Punk podcast or any of his YouTube stuff or Bleeder, I will put the links in the description for this podcast. If you're looking to get a bit more of your Cerebral Jukebox, if you search for Cerebral Jukebox on YouTube, it will now bring up a playlist of performances of all the songs we've covered thus far. And it tends not to be just the official music video, it will be performances that I found from scouring the internet. Also, we do have a playlist on Spotify, which again, if you search for Cerebral Jukebox on Spotify, you'll probably get this podcast and the playlist, which will cover the songs that we've talked about in the episodes and some of the additional songs that we've talked about in episodes as well. If you want to keep up with what I'm doing, you can of course find me at allmylinks.com/Mr. Carl, and it's the MISTER unabbreviated Mr. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much for sticking with us. Don't forget to check out other shows on the We Made This podcast network. There will be a trailer after the next music clip. And the final music clip is going to be a cover of Crazy Horses, which is by the Irish band Throat, with Neil Fallon from Clutch. We talked about it a fair bit in the episode, and I actually love this. It is probably my favourite cover a band has done. So until the next track, you have yourselves a good one. What a show! There they go, smoking up the sky!
Elsewhere on We Made This. The Movie Palace.
So, I mean, I'll open the floor up to you then, Russ, to start off with. Why don't you tell me what your first experience with The Heat of the Night was, and generally, what do you think about the movie overall?
So, in all honesty, I had seen the film, I believe, when I was much younger, probably maybe 8 or 9, and at that point you don't really pick up the themes and found it relatively boring, I believe is my recollection. And I also grew up being around the television show and having a similar feeling about it.
Pick a disc.
I've always been really interested in space travel, so the Apollo space program is kind of a geeky subject for me, so I knew immediately what the song was about, and I'd heard a lot of the audio clips that they used throughout the song. So when I went to the album and listened to it from start to finish, from that point onwards, it was a point of, I don't think you can listen to any of the songs or not get the full impact of the songs unless you listen to the album from start to finish in chronological order, because as you said, it is like an audio book. It's got a chapter one with the speech from JFK, and then you go through all the different missions through Russia and USA, and I think it's an album best listened to as a whole rather than tracks in isolation.
Real Asian Podcast.
You're right, they're trying to say like, oh, we're not going to be that egregious, we're going to be subtle in our racist views and how we erasure Asian Americans from our films.
I'm curious though, what do you guys think went to the thought process? You know, like why?
There's a line in the documentary that says, you know, Hollywood is racist because America is racist, and it's like a catch-22 where you want something to change, but then it's like, oh, but you can't sell Bruce Lee. And so the Hollywood director's like, okay, then we won't put him.
Check out all of these shows and more on the We Made This podcast network.